And, you know, I would go to the meeting. I used to get to the meeting about an hour early because I like to get ready. And these people have been praying for 2 hours and they're still going. And I was getting tired just listening to them. I thought, how on earth do they pray so loud? for hours and hours. But they know how to pray. So A, we need to be righteous through the robe and through the blood of Yeshua. B, we need to learn to pray fervently. And the first point there is the effective fervent prayer of a righteous person avails much. What is effective prayer? And I believe that all prayer is good, amen? All prayer is good. But what we've learned to do, because our lives depend upon it there in Israel, and Josie's a real, she's a real intercessor and a woman of God. I mean, I've gleaned this from her. The way you really pray effectively, pray the word.
Yeah. Yeah.
Pray the word of God.
Yeah.
I like what the Bible says about itself. The what does it say in Hebrews 4:12, I think it is. The word of God is alive. It's powerful. I need the Bible, Josie. The word of God is alive. It's powerful. It's under there. And it's sharper than any two-edged sword. Do you believe that? Why do you believe that? Because if it stays inside the cover of the book, it ain't going to do anything, right? It's got to get out. And I believe it's got to get out into the atmosphere. Now, I do believe that you can pray nice, quiet, meditational prayer. You can pray to God quietly. He knows what's in our hearts. But if we want to see something change, we need to loudly proclaim and declare the word of the Lord. All prayer is good. But what happens when we pray is we take our spirit, which came from God anyway, and hopefully we're all born again and filled with the Holy Spirit. So when you take our spirit and the Holy Spirit and mix it up, you've got a powerful dynamic on your hands. But when you take our spirit, mix it with the Holy Spirit, and then mix it with the word of God, you've got the most powerful dynamic in the universe. I truly believe that we, and I'm including myself, we in the body of Messiah have very little revelation of the authority and the power that God has invested in us. How much does it say in the Bible? 80% of power and authority, right? Right?
Yeah.
No, it doesn't say that. All authority. I get somebody every time. All authority. All. Little word.
80%.
Big meaning. Amen? All authority in heaven and earth. The keys to death and hell. The weapons of our warfare are not mighty, but mighty. So pulling down these strongholds. And we've got the armor of Ephesians 6. You know, then there's these people say, well, I'm just waiting on the Lord. Well, I wonder what they're waiting for. What on earth are they waiting for? What else can God give us? Well, actually, there is one more thing that we missed out on. God must have been a little bit slow that day. Nike got it. Swoosh. Just do it. Nike got our motto. Just do it. God has given us all we need. And ultimately, it's not us. All we have to do is be empty vessels to allow the Spirit of God to work through us, to be his hands, his feet, his mouthpiece. And we need to learn to, we need to learn to proclaim the Word of God. Not only proclaim, we have a prayer meeting that we've just started up at Carmel Assembly at home. And we'd be going 1 or 2 weeks. And a pastor, I think was he a pastor or just a fellow from England had come over and he joined us for that day. And we were talking about proclaiming the word of God. He said, you know, it's even more than that. He said, we have the authority to issue decrees. We can decree things. You know, God is looking for us to change the world. We're his soldiers, we're his co-laborers, we're his fellow workers. I mean, we're all he's got down here. And he's given us his Holy Spirit and he's given us his word. So what we need to do, brothers and sisters, is we need to have a revelation of the level of authority that God has invested in us. And Father, I pray right now, in Yeshua's name, Father, I pray for all of us here tonight, Lord, increase that revelation, increase that revelation in our lives, Lord, that we would know what you have invested in us, Father, and that we would know our potential. But really, it's not our potential, it's your potential through us, God. Yes. So Lord, just touch each and every one of us here tonight. A revelation or a fresh revelation.
Yes.
Or an increase in revelation of that level of authority. Not just to proclaim your word, but Father, to issue forth decrees in Yeshua's name.
Amen.
So just very quickly, and I'm going to wind it up because time's getting on, just a few other points on prayer. And again, this is not my, this is what I learned for Josie, from Josie. But when we pray, you know, I think we're praying many times, we're praying wrong. First of all, I hear people, now this might rattle a few people's theology actually, but you know, I hear people praying to Jesus. Well, he didn't say that. He said, when you pray, pray, ask the Father.
Yes.
Now, God is a God of order. The kingdom, the universe, it's a God, it's in order. And, you know, the Father is always above the Son. And, like, if I sent my son to you on business, you need to treat him like it's me, right?
Mm.
But if my son's beside me and you want to speak to me, you should speak to me direct.
Mm.
And right now, the Son is at the right hand of the Father. And I believe, and he said it, when you pray, ask the Father in my name.
Amen.
And I believe that if we begin to do things God's way, we will see far greater answers to our prayer.
Yeah.
And actually, I came to realize the root of the problem is Frank Sinatra. Because he did it his way, right? We don't want to do it my way. We want to do it Yahweh's way. And I reckon if we do it Yahweh's way, it's going to work a whole lot better.
Yeah.
So number one, pray the word.
Yeah.
Proclaim the word. Decree the word.
Mm.
Of course, what does that mean? If you want to get the word out of you, you've got to get the word in you.
Yeah.
We've got to get it through in our eye gate or in our ear gate.
Yeah.
And we've got to let it sink down a little bit. I think many times, you know, I catch myself doing the same thing.
Yeah.
You know, I wake up in the morning and have my quiet time and I'm already thinking about what I've got to do today, so I'm racing through it. And I get right through a passage, and I think, gee, I don't remember anything I just read. So I go back and I read it. I mean, is that just me or is other people do that as well? What I do is I use my computer actually to read my Bible. So I use the mouse, and I follow the mouse along the words, and I read, I follow the pointer. At one point, I actually had an audio Bible program in my computer. I was listening to it and reading it at the same time, because we've got to get it in.
Mm.
And instead of just going in one ear, down a couple of inches and popping out the other ear, we've got to let it sink into our hearts.
Yeah.
It's got to get into our hearts, change our minds, and we've got to get it back out. Amen?
Yeah.
And why not? The Bible says again, every word that proceeds out of our mouths, particularly if it's the word of God, will achieve that for which it was purposed. Amen?
Amen.
Amen.
Okay, number one, proclaim the word. Number two, pray to the Father in Jesus' name.
Yeah.
Number three, don't ask God to do things. I hear people saying, oh God, please heal this and please do that. And please. He gave us authority. You do it.
Yeah.
So how we pray is we rise up and we take that authority, all authority, and we pray like this. In the name of Yeshua, I speak healing, I proclaim healing, I bind this, I bind it. Not because it's us, but because God gave us the authority to do that. The priest and just, you know, very, very discouraged. And anyway, one day there's a big din, a big noise in the sky, and someone looks through the crack in the ceiling and they see a whole lot of airplanes flying over, and one guy thinks he sees the, you know, the star, the symbol of the US Air Force. And all of a sudden, you know, faith and hope starts to rise up. And a little bit later, according to how the story went, there's a big ruckus outside, and a great big corporal, a marine, but he's only a corporal, kicks the door in and says, who wants out? Now that guy was just a corporal, but he was wearing the uniform of the United States Marines. He was carrying the full authority of the President of the United States of America. And if we are the people that God has called us to be, we carry the full authority of heaven and of the God,
Amen.
The King of the universe. Amen.
Mm-hmm.
So when we pray, let's take up that authority and let's be the people God has created us to be, and let's make those proclamations, let's make those declarations in Jesus' name.
Amen.
And the fourth and make the final point, I believe that we need to pray for Israel first.
Yeah.
Because God is a God of order.
Yeah.
God sent Moses down to Egypt and negotiate with the Pharaoh for Israel's release. He said to Moses, you go tell Pharaoh to let Israel, my firstborn son, Let him go. So Israel is God's firstborn son. In another place in the Bible, God says Israel is the head. It's the first of the nations. And I believe that if we will do things again God's way, if we will pray for God's nation, if we will pray for Israel, and then pray for our own needs, our own family, our own church, or our own nation, I believe we will see our prayers answered in greater ways. I've got testimonies of this. In fact, I was in India, and I was speaking to a prayer seminar, I suppose you'd say it was. And again, I'm a little bit out of my depth because it's not my thing, but I was asked to do it, so I didn't say no. So I'm sharing with these intercessors these points I was just sharing just now. And halfway through, I saw a man come in with about a six-year-old boy, and someone came up to me near the end of the meeting and said, they just sent this boy home from hospital, and none of his kidneys are working. So I kind of figured, well, if they sent him home from hospital with no kidneys, he'd probably be sent home to die, right? And they said, would you pray for him? And actually, I said, no, I won't. But I said to the father, I said, sir, you heard what I have been teaching this morning. You're his father. You have authority over that boy's life. Mm-hmm. I want to encourage you. You don't have to do this. But I want to encourage you to stand up in front of all these people. You publicly pray for Israel and the sons of Israel. And then you lay your hands on your son's head and pray for him. And he did it. I ended up back home a couple of weeks later. I got an email from my contact. The boy is back in school. I thought, well, that's pretty amazing. And I kept following the situation. And 6 months, a year, 2 years, the boy was still alive. Then I lost contact with my contact. But nobody can say this for sure, but I would like to believe, yes. I choose to believe, that God healed that boy. God answered that man's prayer because he did what was right in God's order. Amen?
Yeah.
And it says in Malachi that if we don't pay our tithes and our offerings, we rob God.
Yeah.
But God says if we do pay our tithes and offerings, he says, test me in this. Will I not open the windows of heaven and pour out such a blessing that your walls will start to expand? You know, I've had people come up to me and say, oh, David, I can't afford to tithe. You know, the truth is you can't afford not to tithe, based on that scripture, if you're a believer.
Yeah.
And I believe it's the same with praying for Israel. God says, I will bless those who bless you. And then it says, I will curse those who curse you, right? Right?
Yes.
Wrong. It doesn't say that in the Hebrew. What it actually says in the Hebrew is, I will curse or destroy anyone who makes light of you or treats you lightly or takes you lightly. So it's not a matter of being anti-Semitic that gets you in trouble with God. It's a matter of just treating Israel as if it's not important. Not praying for Israel, not standing up, not speaking up on Israel's behalf. God's not pleased with that. So as much as we can't afford not to tithe, I believe we can't afford not to pray for Israel.
Yeah.
And what I'm saying is, let's pray for Israel first. Test God in this.
Yeah.
And I'm not saying you have to pray for a half an hour for Israel before you pray for anything else. Just go into the presence of the Lord with Israel, with the right attitude. You know, everything we have, according to Paul, everything we have comes from the Jewish people. Spiritually speaking, and actually if you look in the natural world, almost everything we have, you know, our art, our music, and much of the science and much of the technology today comes from Israel and the Jewish people. But let's keep it in the spiritual vein here. You know, Yeshua said salvation is of the Jews to the woman of the world. And I believe if we just go into the presence of the Lord, and there's a good example of this in Exodus chapter 28 verse 29, it's God speaking to Moses, and he's instructing Moses, and he's about the priest, and he says, whenever the high priest comes into the presence of the Lord, he should be wearing that ephod with the 12 gems on it, each gem representing a nation or one of the tribes of Israel. And it says that the high priest should carry or bear the names of the sons of Israel on a breastplate over his heart as a memorial to the Lord forever. And I believe if it was good enough for the high priest, and of course in those days it was only a male from the tribe of Levi that could go into the presence of the Lord. But today, because the blood has been shed and the veil has been torn. It doesn't matter whether we're Jew or Greek. It doesn't matter whether we're male or female.